So it's a conundrum.
Thank you very much, sir. Next witness, Sally Jane Norman.
Thank you. Thanks, Phil. Your eloquence is wonderful. I like to follow. This is going to be more rough than ragged. And I'm going to talk about live art. I'm going to talk essentially about dance. And basically, the goal with this rough, ragged stuff is to throw some concepts and some developments out there that possibly can feed into the discussion that I'm sure we're going to have as we move ahead. So to start with something extremely contemporary, early dance meditation. I think this is tangible media, and that shouldn't be looking through. Oops. Oh, God. Have I got the last 10 minutes? That's right. There's some... I'm losing the time a lot. Anyway. That's all right. No, it's just that I seem to have a timer on my smart, which I don't think I have. Okay. Hiroshi Ishii in MIT Media Lab says that we live between symbolic and physical spaces, but actually symbolic and physical spaces in terms of media documentation have been around for a long time. So this is a 6th century BC form of dance notation. It's actually a pan-Athenaic amphora, which was given to the victor of the games, filled with sacred oil, but basically one has to engage with a physical object in order to read this score. And this is something we've been hearing for a very long time. Then, much more recent and a much more abstract system. This is Feuillet. So this is 1700, and it's a notation system that was inspired initially by musical notation, but that lasted for 150 years as a dance notation form, by basically evacuating the person who's performing the movement, the dancer. I've been following dance notation history for a number of years and trying to see where it is and how it is that this ties into the preservation and archival and documentation possibilities of digital resources, which is what we're here to talk about today. So I'm not going to spend a huge amount of time on history, but you go from this Feuillet system, Beauchamp Feuillet, so this is the French Academy. 150 years is a long time to uphold a system in a very, very fast evolving European context. Then you come to this, which is Kevin Tomlinson. He's an English dancing master, choreographer, and what he's done is put the bodies back in. So you've got somehow the vestiges, you can see them at the bottom of the image of the Feuillet floor notation system. You've got the musical stave, which gives the time indications, but with the engravings, you've got a re-injection of the body. So this is a really interesting medium that I think we can look at with respect to what we're able to do in the 21st century, where we're linking highly sophisticated, abstract symbolic systems with quite realistic representations of what we're doing. And then, of course, with wild historic leaps, we come to photography and this could also be film. This is the Gypsies Afternoon Before. And we learn to actually read choreographies, gestures, postures from these much more literal and figurative places. So that this is a very representationalist kind of medium that we're working towards. Painting, photography, film, there's a kind of an isomorphic quality whereby what you see is basically a mirroring, a representationalist mirroring of what's out there. So coming away again from the code, it's really interesting looking at notation practices, seeing the degrees to which very, very heavily symbolic and abstracted phases and periods can give way to something that is much more embodied, figuratively representative, much more literally recognizable, immediately recognizable. And of course, these are essentially high art forms, but of course, popular dance forms were studied as of the late 18th century, the Enlightenment years, and in fact, there was a huge influx of popular dance and popular movement forms into the higher traditions. So I'm not trying to be elitist by specifically showing these examples. So these are kind of analog sources, and even when we get into really high technology developments in film and camera of the 20th and 21st centuries. We want to use the high-speed cameras, for example, to give the images a lot more weight, high-resolution images. We're still caught up in this very figurativist representation, this analog kind of reflection of this thing, which is a moving body. But I think that what we're going towards now is a mix of these two kind of forms, these very figurative isomorphic forms and these much more abstract and symbolic forms. And this is Rudolf von Laban, who's a kind of Hungarian-Austrian, I guess educated himself before he was in the early 20th century. But Laban notation was a very sophisticated form of codifying modern movement. And because of the ways that Laban went about his choreology, his notation systems, they lent themselves remarkably to porting across to computer notation systems as in the late 20th century. And so he's working on issues like spatiality, weight, direction, in extremely abstract ways. And at the same time, he's working with dancers who have, especially the German Expressionist movement, who have an extraordinarily embodied and, subjective kind of corporality that they're trying to push through this notational grid. So this was the system that actually led to the first piece of patented choreography. Hanya Holm was a German Expressionist dancer, and in the 40s she shifted to the US and performed Broadway-type shows like Kiss and Kate, which was the first piece of patented choreography, and it was patented because love notation meant that it was possible to script it. So we're moving towards a kind of a knowledge transfer system that is much closer perhaps to what we think of as being late 20th, early 20th century. So there are several quite strong abstract systems of this kind. There's Benesch notation, which is also a very rich system. That was an English-based system, and then there's an Israeli-based system called Eshkol Vachman. And they have their different idiosyncrasies in terms of how they depict movement, in terms of how much weight they accord to different types of bodies and gestures. And basically, they're being spurred on also by growing animation industry practices as of the late 1980s. Software that was being developed for game animation, for example, in 1987, was the first piece of dance notation software developed specifically for Apple II. And so this is going on at the same time as notation systems are working their way into the fabric of medical research, diagnostic research, and all of this is creating an incredibly interesting interdisciplinary mishmash. One of the, I guess, very important sort of interactions with these different categories of people. Tim talked about nutritionists and sound engineers and librarians and all these different kinds of scholars. Well, at Simon Fraser University in Vancouver, this guy called Tom Calvert, who ran the Computer Systems Engineering Lab, who was a kinesiologist, one of the computer scientists, and one of the people in the use of bodily representation and practices. And Calvert developed a piece of software called Life Forms. And he worked with a dancer called Tekla Schiphorst, who's also a wonderful programmer. And together, they were looking at something that was initially a kind of diagnostic tool. It was for looking at deformities and corrective movement therapies and so on. And Tekla realized that this was actually an amazing scripting and scoring tool for choreographers. She then hooked up Calvert with a wonderful choreographer called Lewis Cunningham. And boom, they devised this system, this is the kind of movements that we're going through. I'm sorry, I'm a bit, I seem to have lost the timing thing, which is good. So I'm slightly less neurotic about showing these slides. So this is the basis for the life form system. You've got a dancer, you've got a notation display system, you enter your notation and data, You store it, you can tap into it, you can rework it, you can retrieve it. There's a malleability about information, about sequences of a body movement that previously hadn't existed. The Cunningham work was inspired by the fact that life forms has a sequence editor. So you can stretch sequences, you can expand gestural sequences, you can play around with their timings, you can completely reverse them. And what Cunningham discovered was that more than being just a scripting and coding tool, he actually had an expressive choreographic tool, because by playing around with digital data in ways that one cannot play around with the body of a human, can answer Cunningham's own or those of his crew, of his company, you could come up with insights into movement that cannot viscerally be imagined by anyone else. We have intuitive and entrained senses of how we move, and we tend to stay within that intuitive and entrained envelope of our gestural vocabularies and repertories. If you want to do something radically different, which something like Cunningham does, then you've got to find a way to get out of those entrained envelopes. And so by tweaking parameters that have nothing to do with your visceral sensibility, you come up with notions of direction, notions of contrast, of counterpoint in your movement sequences that are just unthinkable, literally. So there's a whole new gestural repertoire that's born out of Cunningham's work with life forms. He then teamed up with a guy called Paul Kaiser, who runs a group, the Open-Ended System, in New York. And Cunningham, for a piece called Biped, which is 1999, one of his milestone pieces, but he's got nothing but milestone pieces, he choreographed it using life forms, and then Cunningham, then Kaiser actually pulled out extracts of these choreographed sequences, turned them into digital avatars, self-standing, as it were, digital avatars that are then projected on a screen in front of the dancers as a kind of very strange kind of an accompaniment of these real and virtual dancers in this 1999 piece. So I think what I'm trying to say here is that there's an extraordinary fertile kind of zone where this malleable digital data is actually being very forcibly and in an almost muscular way, confronted with the physicality of the body. Okay, William Forsythe, of course, used love notation for his CD-ROM that he did, Art and Type CD-ROM at ZKM in the late 90s. So basically what this made possible was that when you perform a gesture, you could just attach kind of a vector graphic or some kind of a sketch form to the gesture. Forsythe is capable of doing a perfect circle. And this is a slightly more recent piece of his called Asynchronous Objects with the Ohio State University Computer Science Group. These forms are actually the movements of a dancer performing this synchronous, asynchronous objects piece of work, but there were multiple dancers. And I don't have time now, but you can look this up. You can actually see the dance sequence, which is about 15 dancers with flat tabletops that they're working around and working on. But you can also choose whether you want to see statistical renderings of where it is that the movement is weighted in the room, of how the movement is structured in terms of heights, in terms of directionality. You can actually flip from one ground to another to another, and you get about 10 different readings of this dance piece. And they're incredibly insightful. You can come to think about movement in ways that you simply couldn't without these kinds of tools, which this is what we need to talk about. The transmedia knowledge base is something that's been developed by Carla Fernandes, who's a Portuguese scholar, semiotician actually. And this is a base which is a study of choreographic practices in Portugal and in Europe, and also dealing with Dutch choreographers. And it's an annotated video database in part. It's a text base in part. It's a motion capture base in part. What Carla and her team are doing is pulling together all kinds of different metadata pertaining to choreographic practices and basically putting them out there in the same way that I guess Bob was talking about with his jokes. You know, we're talking about getting large masses of data that no individual is going to have the time, energy, or intelligence to tap into as that data deserves. So putting the stuff out there for others to enjoy. Very quickly for the last minutes, I just want to completely flip from the dance and choreography side of things to the questions of interactive art, which of course is something that people have been trying to document in some sort of sustainable form for several decades now. An archive is a collection that was started in Paris in the late 90s by Anne-Marie Pivet. Antonio Mutras is a Barcelona Catalan artist who was the first subject of one of these anarchive interactive art CD-ROMs. He actually published an inter-ROM because he wanted it to be a CD-ROM with an internet connection. This is 99. The Mutras, as it was at the time, of course, is unmakeable. It's dead. And this is why. It's sitting here. We've got Motorola, we've got PowerPC, we've got Intel, and then we flip through to the different generations of Macs sitting on top of that, and then we flip through to the different formats, CD-ROM, DVD-ROM, or Wide Web. And where's Mutras in here? He's kind of sitting up on top of all of this software development, 1999. And this is where people are trying to actually create a stable documentary source for an extremely complex piece of interactive art. And it's impossible. It's dead. So there's been a new edition which is entirely web-based, but that doesn't solve the problem, because of course all the plugins evolved just as fast as the previous fixed formats. Dominique Pignon is the French scholar who gave me these slides, and he works on emulators. And there's an actual aesthetic of emulators and emulator buildings. They're looking at the generational typologies of these electronic platforms or computer platforms. And this is a cyberzoology. You know, how do you go from a Mac OS to the snow leopard from 99? Well, you get a sheep shaver. This is kind of emulator. So these are the kinds of issues that I think we're dealing with when we're talking about the instability of the data that we're looking at. Art and Tech, the German, is a Zedcam-based collection of interactive artists' CD-ROMs. Now you can only follow through linear documentation on YouTube. So it's kind of, anyway, over the time.